Hey guys, welcome to this week's episode of Lost Origins. I'm Andrew, one of the co-hosts here. Real quick, just want to say thank you to everybody who has shared, liked, subscribed, commented, engaged, anything with our show means the world to us. Whether you're an OG or you've recently discovered us, we don't exist without you, so thank you. Today's episode of Lost Origins is going to be mind-bending. And I can say that because this is a person that we've spoken to before. In season one, we connected with none other than David Mathisen. This guy is a genius, he is brilliant through and through, and I know what you're thinking. Oh my God, are we ever going to hear from somebody that was not on season one? Yep, we'll get there. Cool your jets. We really wanted the opportunity to be able to just reconnect with some old friends and get caught up as to what their work is looking at now, the current state of things, and just make sure that we're able to lift up people who have helped us in the past with promoting the show, getting the word out there, and asking the hard questions. So back to David Mathisen. David Mathisen has penned several tomes on the subject of star myths, the ancient mythologies found across different cultures in the ancient world. He's looked at the zodiacal system. He's looked at so many different connections throughout our ancient past. And today, we're going to pick up the conversation where we left off in season one. But CK and I are also going to discuss what David is calling the authentic self. It is one hell of a conversation. It's one that you do not want to miss. You may want to take some notes here and there. And if you have any questions, hit us up in the comments below. So let's jump into season two, episode four of Lost Origins with David Mathisen, Star Myths, and the Authentic Self. Let's go.
Holler.
Welcome to this week's episode of Lost Origins. I'm Andrew. CK, how are you, man?
I am doing really, really well.
Good, man.
And how are you?
I'm living in a good way. Life is good. Work is great. Kids are amazing. We are getting ready to head to Hawaii this week.
You are so ready to ride.
I'm so ready, dude. It's going to be so good.
Dude, Friday.
Friday. It couldn't come quick enough, man. So, and for everybody out there who's like listening and going, oh my God, are they not going to release an episode? Don't worry.
No, he's on it.
We got a backup plan. Yeah. So, yeah. You'll be good.
Andrew doesn't allow his luxuriating to take away from participation, you know?
Which the girlfriend appreciates, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah. She's like, oh, sure, yeah, the podcast is important. Yeah, yeah. Here, no, I'm just going to be here at the beach.
I'll just be at Waikiki Beach.
Yeah,
and,
do your audio stuff. Cool, yeah.
So that's a thing. But, you know, before we jump into this week's episode, we do have to once again throw love to the homies at Inner Traditions and Baron Company. I'm sure by now our listeners have checked out that site and, you know, innertraditions.com. And if you haven't, like, for shame, people.
For shame.
Get online and get with it, because not only can you dig into some of the best ancient mysteries on the face of the earth, as penned by some of the most, like, thoughtful and scholarly researchers and authors on the planet, there's a ton of other amazing content on that site. And I was poking around today, and I came across a book that made me think of you, dude. Because you and I have had several conversations just about, like, the nature of reality and consciousness and, you know, more specifically, DMT.
Indeed.
And I came across this book called DMT, The Spirit Molecule. And
Dr. Rich Strassman.
Oh, you know it.
Indeed.
Okay.
That's the jam. Yeah, that's the original.
So, like, obviously, you've read it then?
I have.
Okay. Thoughts? Good? Is it good? I was going to pick it up, and I wanted to.
I would say it's dense.
Okay.
I would not necessarily say that it's good, hey, you won't be able to put this down. But in terms of it being the first real study, like real deal controlled study of intravenously injected dimethyltryptamine,
mm-hmm.
there's nothing else. I mean, there's nothing to compare it to. There's nothing else like it, you know, like the fact that Strassman got this DEA certified program, or his entire testing program was DEA certified.
Oh, really?
You know, makes you be able to do a lot of other things that I think other international researchers and other researchers in the United States without that designation just simply can't do.
Sure.
But I think the coolest thing, there's, or at least like the most profound stuff from the book, or at least that in my opinion was profound, is just how common the deity experiences, the like extra personal, extraterrestrial.
The multidimensional and like.
But specifically that more often than not, people specifically with, you know, they didn't use the combusted form of DMT. They're not using ayahuasca. They're using, you know, injected intravenous. They saw this demiurge character where they interacted with some sort of other extra personal consciousness. And I think like seeing so many people have some almost across the board positive experience with something that made them feel more connected to everyone because they finally met themselves is a really interesting kind of thing.
Wow.
Yeah.
So maybe I need to have that be the read on the airplane to Hawaii.
DMT the spare molecule?
Yeah.
Yeah. I can drop it off for you before Friday.
Hell yeah. Let's do that. Yeah. Also, the cover is, you know, done by Alex Gray.
Alex Gray. Yeah.
So you can't go wrong there. So yeah, that's what, you know, definitely caught my eye.
Yeah, that image is the one of when you die, right? It's I forgot the name of the piece, but it's the soul.
I don't remember the name of it.
The body and
the room with the eyeballs and
yeah, just pulling up.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's so good.
And you know, true Alex Gray fashion, it's just mind boggling. Yeah, and you can look at it for forever and see all the different things. And,
yeah.
So
yeah, DMT. We could probably have an entire season of episodes just on how DMT could potentially tie us back to the human origins.
Yeah, I think maybe you know, maybe we'll get into that today's episode even. Yeah, too. I don't know. Like there's, you know, so
David's a heady dude.
Yeah, it should be good stuff. Before we go, you know, poke that bear and talk about our conversation that's about to happen with David. I got to tell you another thing that happened with Eden. I feel like that's kind of becoming a common theme. Like our listeners are getting to know my daughter through, through podcasting. Yeah. So we're sitting on the deck over the weekend and, you know, we're just, Shay and I are out there having our morning coffee and, you know, it's a nice, you know, Saturday morning and Eden cruises out and we start talking and I have no idea what got us here. I cannot remember, but she starts talking about these song lyrics, right? And she says, "Take my horse to the hotel room." And I'm like, "Wait, what?" She's like, no, there's this song that says, "Take my horse to the hotel room." And so I'm thinking, okay, hold on.
Country?
No, in my mind, I'm thinking, okay, you're cute. You don't understand that instead of horse.
Saying, take my horse to the hotel room,
right? So I get curious and I hop on Google, do a little digging. It's the opposite of what I expected to find.
It's like a legit kid song.
No.
"Take my horse to the hotel room."
It's Lil Nas and Billy Ray Cyrus that wrote this song that the lyrics literally are, "Take my horse to the, High Toll Road," right? But when they sing it, and I'll play a clip. Here's a clip. So when they sing that, it literally sounds like, I can see how people say, you know, "Take my horse to the hotel room." And then parents are like, "Wait, are they saying horse or what?" It's this huge confusing thing.
But it's like, maybe you get to a certain level of baller. Like when your kid is
totally
like, you know, Miley Ray Cyrus, like they have their own, they're like, "Take my menagerie to all of their respective chambers." You know, the peacock never rooms next to the zebra.
Or it's just Billy Ray Cyrus sitting in his house going, "Well, now that we don't have Hannah Montana paying our mortgage, I gotta do something. So,
and seriously, that horse, we can't be paying for that horse hotel room anymore. It's really gonna break us.
Yeah, the fee that they tack on, you know, even through Airbnb for cleaning up horse manure, it's significant.
It's no joke. It's not a joke. Way more serious than toll roads.
So, you know, once again, I think this tees us up nicely to check in with Eden and see
what else does a sixth grader have to say about some stuff.
Well, let's check it out. Heyo, welcome to this week's installment of Ask a Sixth Grader. Once again, I have Eden joining me in the studio today. Eden, what's up? How are you?
Good.
How's your day going?
Good.
Yeah, anything fun happened today?
Well, at school, our class dog, his name is Bear, and so he had to go to the bathroom, and he kept barking at Miss Runner when she was trying to teach.
Yeah.
He kept barking at her.
When you gotta go, you gotta go.
Yeah.
Right?
And then we got to take him outside, and we got like 15 extra minutes of recess.
Bonus. Maybe he was just looking out for you. Maybe he just wanted you to be able to have, you know, some extra play time. And so he was just, he was doing you a solid.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. You want to talk some history?
Yeah.
All right. So tell me what you know about Atlantis.
I don't really know anything about that.
You don't know anything about Atlantis? So let me jog your memory, okay? Because I know you've heard this story. So basically, Atlantis was this, you know, continent or city, depending on, you know, which theory or story you're hearing it from, that was, you know, a huge world power a very, very, very long time ago. And then there was a huge cataclysm. Okay. And they had like all this advanced technology. They were a very advanced civilization very, very long time ago. And then there was this huge cataclysm, right? Do you know what a cataclysm is?
No.
So it's like a huge destructive event, right? So like a comet hitting the earth, that's like, and then all these volcanoes are erupting. It's just like mass chaos. Okay. So this huge cataclysm happens and it causes the city of Atlantis, the continent of Atlantis, to sink underwater. And now it's this lost continent that nobody can find.
Oh, yeah, I've heard that.
Right, I knew you heard that. So there's a lot of people out there that think it's just myth, right? They just think it's a story. Mm-hmm. And then there's a lot
of people. But if it was a myth, then they would have, like, proved it by now, I think. Because, like, they said, like, someone, like, they said that unicorns are myths or something. Like, they said that stories are myths. Like they said that.
Well, a lot of people still think it's a myth because it hasn't been found, right? So they still think it's just a story.
After like 10 years of looking for the giant squid, a lot of people thought it was a myth, but then they found it. So
sometimes you got to just keep looking, right? Like when you can't find the thing you're looking for in your room, and then it's probably just stuffed in one of your drawers or under your bed.
Yeah. Like when I couldn't find my notebook.
Right. Nice try when I tell you to clean up the room. So Atlantis supposedly sank and nobody's been able to find it. And people think a lot of different things about Atlantis. Some people think that it's like in the Mediterranean. Some people think that it's outside of the Straits of Gibraltar, which is, you know, over near Africa, basically. There's some people that think that it's located down in like Cuba, which is down.
What about the Mariana Trench?
The Mariana Trench, maybe. It's pretty deep down there. Nobody really knows what's down there, right?
Mm-hmm. Nobody's ever made it to the bottom.
Nobody's ever made it to the bottom?
And if like, no, that's, you would die because of the pressure.
Because of the pressure?
And if it was true, it would, and if it was on the Mariana Trench, we probably would not find it unless we did like this really like heavy duty robot to go down there and look.
Have a robot bottom. Do our bidding for us?
Yes, that'd because be cool. It would crush a human.
Yeah, like, right? Yeah. So my favorite theory about where Atlantis is that it's in Antarctica, right? So
no, it's under our house.
Under our house?
I'm joking.
Man.
That would be scary.
That would be scary. So the theory basically says that, you know, a long, long time ago, Antarctica was in a different location on our planet, right? So over time, the continents shift and they move, right? Mm-hmm. And so
it's going to be, sorry for interrupting you, but like it's going to be really hard to find if it is in Antarctica because of global warming and stuff. It's just adding more water on top of that. So then like if a person does go underwater, they're going to have to swim deeper because than usual.
So because of global warming, we're starting to see a lot of that ice melt and a lot of those ice sheets recede, right?
That causes polar bears to die because they have nowhere to live.
It does. And that's super sad and that super sucks.
And like polar bears are one of my top 10 favorite animals.
Same. And as human beings, it's our responsibility to take care of this planet, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it sucks that we're not doing that. But as the ice is melting, we're starting to be able to see like structures on Antarctica. So if nobody's ever been on Antarctica, right? And, you know, a lot of people think that Antarctica wasn't discovered until like the early 1800s. How are there structures there that are like huge, huge, sophisticated structures? And, you know, you'd have to go back in time to a time where there was no ice on Antarctica. And that was a very long time ago. So I think that Atlantis is on Antarctica. What do you think about that?
I mean, it would make sense and stuff. I want to tell them a fun fact.
What's your fun fact?
So 2 years ago, my dad told me that in 40 years, if we don't stop littering in the ocean, then all the ocean animals would be gone. So technically now in 38 years, if we don't stop littering, then like there will be no more ocean animals. And I don't know if you guys know, but my favorite animal is a shark. And that means my favorite animal would be extinct. And most of my favorite animals are underwater.
And so we need to do a better job.
Yeah, so I hope like
taking care
all
of the
people listening will understand that like the
Pick
ocean.
Up your trash, right?
Yeah, like if you see a piece of trash, don't just like look at it and then be like, oh, somebody else will pick it up. Because like what if everybody else thought that?
Right.
And then it would go in the ocean. And like, I think plastic straws are terrible and because they keep getting up turtles' noses and stuff.
Yeah.
And like if they like try to sleep, it'll like go up their nose and like out of their head. And then that's like,
that's not cool.
That they die.
No, I really like how passionate you are about taking care of our planet. I think it's very important. And I think a lot of people out there should take a page from your playbook. So,
guys, I accidentally said that's not bad. I meant that is bad.
Thank you for the clarification.
Yes.
So this was fun. I'm glad you came on the show this week, Eden. You got to go clean your room.
I don't want to.
Thanks, Eden.
Bye.
So that's what happens when you ask a sixth grader about Atlantis.
Things get wet.
So it's always amazing just to pick her brain and see like where she goes and like what she instinctually like.
Where did you hear about those things?
Yeah. And I do remember, you know, we watched, did you ever see the Disney movie Atlantis?
Of course.
It's so good. It's so good. And we've spent we've watched that movie so many times. but you know, I don't know if maybe she's connecting it there or what, or just, you know, from being around me and me being a nerd and like.
It's probably that one. I think it's that one.
It's probably that one. I mean, that kid, she will like watch Ancient Aliens the night it premieres. And then we watch it again like Saturday when I'm ready to watch it or whatever. Like we sit down and watch it again.
And then maybe she could like when you leave the house, she could go down into that room you have downstairs with all the red threads attached to all the different photographs of the places.
She is Charlie Day in the mail. She's like, where does it all go? Oh my God, it's so good. Okay, so let's riff on today's show real quick. We've got David Mathisen coming back on the show, another veteran. I do promise that, you know,
be other people there who are not on season one.
There will be others. It'll be good. But David, this guy's work, man, like I'm really excited for you to be able to have a conversation with him. The last time we talked, you know, amazing conversation. His work is extensive. So when he came on the show last time, you know, I always like to make sure that I'm able to like chew up some of the work before we have these conversations. So he sends me a copy of one of his books. And there's this package on my doorstep one day that it literally looked like a box of shoes from Amazon or something. Like it was
it dented my concrete.
Yeah. And I open it and it's this book. And I'm like, holy hell, our conversation's in like a week and a half. There's no way. But I have gone through it cover to cover. And it's so mind-bending, dude. Like the guy he's so thoughtful with his research, but then he looks at things from a different perspective, right? Like when we have conversations with guys like Scott Walter and Scott Crichton, and then in last season we talked to a lot of dudes that are like boots on the ground. They're analyzing, you know, these megalithic structures and looking at like, what does this mean for the origin of our species? David's looking at it from a completely different perspective, and that's the night sky. And he's connecting what we see in the heavens to myths and then the commonalities of those myths across the globe, right? And so like, why does this culture on this side of the earth share these commonalities with this culture on this other side of the earth? And they supposedly had no contact, you know, thousands of years ago, but yet we see all these common threads and common denominators, and it's super fascinating stuff. So I'm really excited for you to kind of...
And he's been doing this for the better part of a decade, right? After...
I think like 10 to 15 years. I mean, it's a long time. I mean, his website, I want to say, has like 1,000 or like 1,200 blog posts, dude. Like, yeah, it's not an easy undertaking to build something that monumental. So he's definitely been around. He's done his research. It's fascinating. Let's get him on the horn.
Let's do the thing.
All right, let's go. David, how are you, man?
Hey, Andrew, I am really good. Thanks for having me. It's great to be back, and welcome to CK as well.
Yeah, thanks, man. I'm glad to join the conversation.
I'm so excited to get you back on the show, man. Last season, I mean, the conversation was just such a fun exchange, man. And your work, like, the first time you sent me one of your books, that package showed up on my doorstep and I was a little confused. I'm like, what the? I didn't order anything from Amazon. Like, what is this enormous box? And it was your monstrous tome that came out of that thing. I mean, your work is no joke, man. So it's really excited to get you back on the show. I'm excited to pick your brain, see what you have going on, dig into your new book, your new research. And before we do that, maybe for the, you know, the uninitiated uninitiated, there we go. Sorry about that. You know, let's give them kind of the 35,000 foot view of who you are, your work, what's your research digging into, you know, just a little history lesson if you could for us.
Yeah, sure. Well, tell you, I haven't been initiated into any mysteries either. So nothing I'm sharing is anything that I got from any secret initiated thing. So, but I do want to say welcome to each and every listener. And I hope that there'll be some valuable topics that we touch on that will help people with what they're seeking out there. So I got into this, you know, it starts... Well, I was born on a Thursday.
David Copperfield.
A long, long time ago. But I grew up loving the myths, and I grew up loving the stars. I would go out and look at the stars. My dad would take me out, and we'd look at the stars together. And we had these books that were written by H.A. Rey, who's very important in this story. But I never envisioned the constellations using any other system. I had the H.A. Rey book for kids. That was a children's version of his H.A. Rey book, The Stars, A New Way to See Them, which everyone should have in their house, I recommend. And H.A. Rey, if people are scratching their heads going, wait, that name sounds so familiar, he and his wife, Margaret Rey, wrote the Curious George books.
That's so awesome.
So he's also... You know, not only are those illustrations famous and well-known, but the way he was very frustrated at the way that the constellations were depicted. And he writes in his book that he wrote in 1952, you know, they're either usually these really flowery outlines that are really imaginative, but you can't look up in the sky and see anything like them.
Sure.
Or they're these kind of random geometric piles of lines that look like, you know, pickup sticks that is impossible to really remember, and it doesn't really help you pick them out in the sky either. So he suggested a different way, and we can talk about some of his outlines. It's easier actually to take a look on my website and see the images. It's hard to kind of describe over the sound, but we'll talk about it. But his outlining system turns out to be very, very helpful for seeing the connections between the myths and the stars. So fast forward to, I had an opportunity to teach literature at the college level, going back actually to the military academy where I did my undergraduate. I did a graduate, got a graduate degree in literature at Texas A&M, and got to teach the Odyssey of Homer, or allegedly of Homer, at the college level, which was a fantastic experience, and got to meet the fantastic translator of the Odyssey, who has now passed away, Professor Fagels from Princeton. Fantastic translations of the Iliad and the Odyssey. He came to West Point and talked to all the instructors and professors there. It was a really special experience. But anyway, it wasn't until after this that, through the work of Graham Hancock, I was actually, my parents were going to Machu Picchu, and I thought, oh, I'm going to get, my mom's birthday is coming up, I'm going to get her a book that has to do with Machu Picchu. And I started searching around, and I found a book by Graham Hancock, who I hadn't heard about before at this point. Mm-hmm. And I bought this book for her, Heaven's Mirror, which is a fantastic, beautiful, glossy photographs by Santa Faya, and the text, you know, talks about all the processional cycles. And I was just fascinated by that. And he talks about Hamlet's Mill in there. And I said, oh, this is the book I'm going to get for my mom. And that got me started reading other Graham Hancock books that afterwards I went and bought Graham Hancock's Fingerprints of the Gods. But also I bought Hamlet's Mill, which is mentioned in a lot of Graham Hancock's work as being important. And Hamlet's Mill talks about a connection, a lost system so ancient that the dust of centuries had already settled on it by the time the Greeks came on the scene. That's one of their, almost a direct quotation from like page Roman numeral 5 from the intro.
Okay.
And they talk about how it's like this system is scattered around the globe. It's worldwide. It connects the myths of in the ancient Norse to the myths of the Maya, to the myths of Japan. And I was just, you know, I had to know more. And they talk about how it's like a mist painting. There's another metaphor they use where there's a little piece here and a little piece there, these mist paintings that are famous. They were very popular in China in the classical painting, you know, where they just kind of draw a little detail here and a detail there, and the rest is just kind of mist.
Hmm.
Well, they said that's what this system is like. All we have are these broken pieces around the globe. And I just really became fascinated by that, and really had to start digging into it further and further. And it turns out that my familiarity with the constellations, I was also in the Army for a long time, where you spend a lot of time, was in the infantry, spend a lot of time just lying out under the stars, you know, sitting there with your rifle, looking sure. out into the darkness. And I remember one time actually looking up, and I didn't even know there was a comet coming around. It was the comet Hale-Bopp. Mm-hmm. I was out in the desert of California, and it had been a long day. It was like 2 a.m. I was walking from one point to another across the desert, and I looked up and saw this brilliant comet. And this was kind of before the internet really took off, and I didn't even know that there was a comet coming. So I got a chance to really become familiar with the stars. I was familiar with the myths. I'd taught them at the college level before I even encountered Hamlet's Mill. And I started seeing that they were correct about this allegation that the myths are based on the stars. And not only that, they talk about the Bible being based on the stars. And I wasn't too comfortable with that because I was taking the Bible literally, really seriously, reading the Bible a lot. And I knew the Bible really well. But when sure. they talked about, well, this story is related to the stars, I said, oh, no, that can't possibly be right. I know that Samson actually was, you know, must have been a literal person. But they said, no, it actually relates to the constellations. And then they pointed something else out in the book of Revelation. And I said, boy, that really does actually sound like it matches up with the stars. And that just kind of became an obsession to where now for the past 10 years, I've really been wanting to figure out the vocabulary and the grammar, if you will, of this celestial language that all the myths are speaking. And so you referenced how big these books are. I have to write a really short one that'll just be kind of a less intimidating one.
Try to balance it out
one,
a little bit.
Last one was 912 pages.
Use really small type, you know?
Yeah. I've been criticized for using small type, so now I use larger type. But anyway, long story short, I really want to make this available to people, what I've discovered. I'm not the first person, as I just explained, to see these connections. But with the outlines of H.A. Rey, I believe I've uncovered some connections that, you know, even Hamlet's Mill, they didn't really see how it all fit together. I'm not saying I see how it all fits together, but they were writing in 1969. H.A. Rey's books only came out, Stars book only came out in 1952. So I don't think they were really familiar with H.A. Rey's outlining system, because if they were, I think they made a few misidentifications that they wouldn't have made if they were using H.A. Rey.
Okay.
But long story short, I believe it's an incredibly important area of research, because this ancient worldwide system is yet another piece of evidence that points towards the existence of a now forgotten lost civilization, alongside all the archaeological evidence that we've heard about. The mythological evidence is overwhelming that the same system was being used in the Americas as was being used in ancient Egypt or ancient Mesopotamia or the Norse myths, or Africa or the Pacific Islands or Australia or ancient China, ancient India. And that evidence, it's extremely abundant evidence, but that obviously flies in the face of the conventional paradigm of human history.
Right. And I think that's one of my favorite takes on your work, honestly, is, you know, when you look at ancient mysteries, you look at, you know, our origins, where we come from, you know, more often than not, it's the megalithic record that gets analyzed, and rightfully so. And, you know, you're looking into the sky and into the heavens, so to speak. And I think that that's such a neat shift in perspective. And it's one that's definitely warranted, because the stars were insanely important to these people. And we're going to talk about that as it relates to the alignment of different structures, you know, all across the globe in our conversation today. To kind of tee us up for that transition, take us to Africa. So in your latest book, you talk about some of the star myths of Africa. Kind of unpack some of that for us, if you could. What are some of the biggest takeaways that you found in your research? Some of the biggest myths that maybe you see commonality across the globe, but maybe they originated in Africa.
Right. Well, that's a great place to start, because it doesn't get talked about nearly enough. But there are, of course, sacred stories and traditions from every single culture around the world, including, of course, Africa. There are many different myths, different nations across Africa, different cultures, different peoples, but there are patterns to their myths in Africa. And what's really amazing is they connect up with myths from other cultures that you wouldn't necessarily expect. So one thing that really was an eye-opener to me, so this most recent book that I published is called The Ancient Worldwide System.
Yep.
And its subtitle is Star Myths of the World, Volume 1, Second Edition. Because what I did was I wrote, my first book was actually called The Mathisen Corollary. And when I wrote that, I was still taking the Bible literally, but I was talking about connections between the myths and the stars. And it wasn't until there was a period between The Mathisen Corollary and my next book, The Undying Stars, which came out in 2014 and is still probably my best seller. Continues to be very popular.
Nice.
The Undying Stars is when, between the first book and the second book, I went through this crisis where I had to kind of reassess my own belief system and admit to the evidence that is overwhelming that the Bible is based on the stars, not on literal people. So after that book, then I started into this star myth series. Volume 1 came out in 2015. Volume 2 was looking just at ancient Greece. I'll get back to Africa in just a second. Volume 3 is Star Myths of the Bible. And then Volume 4 was Norse Myths. And I've written a couple others in between there that aren't part of that series. Well, the Norse myths are very fascinating to me because I grew up with the Norse myths. My grandfather was born in Norway. I knew that, you know, the Norse myths from a child. I knew that this is the myths of the, you know, people from Scandinavia, where my father's side of the family is from. That was fascinating to me. But what's really fascinating is the, you know, who's the most famous figure in the Norse myths that everybody knows about? That you guys would say.
Thor.
I mean, Odin is also extremely important and well-known, but Thor is really well-known, and he was extremely popular among the Norse. I mean, they would wear his hammer. We found, you know, many, many amulets from the Norse period of the Thor's hammer that men and women would wear around their neck. And Thor is a thunder god. He has the most powerful weapon of all the Norse gods. He has this powerful, you know, we've all seen it in the movies, this powerful hammer, right? Chris Hemsworth just puts his hand out.
Mjolnir.
And then, here it comes. Mjolnir just flies into his hand, and it's irresistible. Well, in the Norse myths, the Norse gods relied on Thor. If Thor and his hammer weren't there, they would have been overrun by the ice giants and the Jotuns that are always trying to destroy Asgard and all the gods and goddesses and Earth as well. So Thor was essential. And he's a thunder god, but he's a very jolly god. He's jovial. And in fact, the word jovial, which is in our language, comes from a different god whose name is Jove. Jove, of course, is a different thunder god who also happens to be jovial. That's why we have that word Jove, jovial. Jove is the father god in the Latin. They call him Jove Pater, which means father, or Jupiter. Jupiter corresponds to Zeus. Well, they all have this most powerful weapon, right? What's the most powerful weapon of Zeus and Jupiter?
Thunderbolt.
The lightning. Thunderbolt. Exactly. Well, guess what? It's the same constellation as Thor. It's the same figure in the sky has a very square head, which is why these figures have a big square beard. Usually a figure that corresponds to this constellation will have a full beard, as does Thor, as does Zeus and Jupiter. And this figure in whatever myth system will almost always have the most powerful weapon, the thunderbolt weapon. Well, so when I revisited, so I realized after writing volume one in 2015, well, most people are going to start with volume one, but I've written all these books since then, and I've learned so much more from examining the Greek myths even more closely when I wrote volume two, examining the Bible even more closely when I wrote volume three, examining the Norse myths when I wrote volume four. I realized I needed to go back and update volume one.
Sure.
And so volume one originally had some myths from Africa, but in the interim, I had discovered there's a thunder god from the Yoruba people of Africa, and the Yoruba actually have had a diaspora, meaning they've been scattered around the world for economic and other geopolitical, you know, often it's because of disasters or oppression that people end up having a diaspora and leaving their home.
Okay.
But there are Yoruba traditions. Now there are pockets of Yoruba traditions around the world. So the Yoruba are a very important set of myths, and they have a god and a goddess, but the god's name is Shango. I may not be pronouncing it exactly right. It's often spelled X-A-N-G-O, or sometimes it's spelled S-H-A-N-G-O, but that god is also a thunder god. But instead of carrying a hammer like Thor does, he carries a tremendous axe, but his axe is like the thunder axe. Well, as I was learning about Thor for volume four, Norse gods, Norse mythology, I noticed that the stars of the weapon that this constellation, okay, so this constellation that plays a thunder god around the world, and including in the Maya, the myths of the Maya, there's a thunder god. who I argue corresponds to this same constellation. And it's really helpful if I can show the picture, but people can go on my website and I've got videos about this constellation. It's the constellation Hercules. I'm not talking about the hero Hercules at the moment. We have a constellation in the sky, which we call Hercules. It has a huge kind of club-shaped implement that is brandishing over its head. The head is actually square in shape because it's created by these four stars that are in the shape of almost a perfect square. H.A. Rey calls that little square the keystone. And the constellation Hercules has this distinctive outline where the figure has a deep lunge, kind of like you're doing lunges, you know, with a barbell across your shoulders, where one leg is really deep knee bend kind of behind him. And it turns out there are ancient Greek pottery showing Zeus in this exact lunge. And also Heracles or Hercules happens to be the son of Zeus. He's often depicted in this exact lunge with the same weapon raised up overhead. And even in the Americas, like some of the depictions on the Gate of the Sun in Tiwanaku, which is this mysterious site down by Lake Titicaca near the border of Bolivia, and has these enormous megalithic blocks. There are also artistic depictions of a figure who's carrying like a thunderbolt type implement in this same deep lunge. And in Maya codices, there are pictures of this figure in the same deep knee lunge. So when I encountered the myth of Shango, I looked at the details of that story, show that he's actually corresponds to the same figure as Thor and Zeus and all these other thunder gods around the world. And even some of the aspects of the story where he is given buffalo horns, there's a constellation right in front of Shango that looks like it could be the buffalo horns that are given to him by Oya, his consort, one of his consorts who has these buffalo horns. But he is carrying this giant, so the figure in the heavens is carrying this giant sword, and it often appears in myth as a sword, but there are little stars halfway down the sword that in my book, Norse Myths, Volume 4, I argued this is why Thor is envisioned as carrying a hammer. If you connect these little stars up, then that sword turns into looking like a hammer. Well, it could also end up looking like an axe, which is exactly what Shango is carrying in the myths of Africa. So, okay. I mean, this is just, it's a pattern that we find around the world. It's really undeniable when you start to, the myths themselves contain the clues. And there are other myths from Africa that show beyond, in my mind, it's very compelling evidence. I would say conclusive evidence, but we could just say there's a compelling amount of evidence that the myths of Africa are using this exact same system that we find in the far north in the Norse myths, or that we find even over in the Americas, or that we find in the myths of ancient Greece, and we find it in the myths of ancient India too. There's a figure named Bheem who is like a Hercules figure, and he carries around a huge mace. Well, guess what? He's identified with the same constellation in the adventures that Bheem or Bhima, it's spelled Bhima, but they usually drop the A off nowadays. That the adventures that he goes through make it quite clear that he is associated with this constellation.
And so, David, I think all of this stuff seems like every one of the things you touch on could be its own episode. But I would be remiss if I didn't just pull at a little thread, just because you, gave us a little bit of personal insight there as you were going kind of through the history of your own phases, as both a researcher and an author. And just if you would indulge me, and maybe this is something that is a struggle that a lot of our listeners might be dealing with as well, is can you give us just a little bit of insight, as much as you feel comfortable sharing, about your transition from a literalist, a biblical literalist, to somebody who saw the aspects of celestial mechanics as something that was much more sort of grounding of the allegories of both the Bible and maybe other things that you took really personally and seriously? Can you give us a little bit of insight into that transition, that process?
Yeah, sure. And it's an important question, I think, because obviously there are a lot of people who take the Bible literally and have a lot of their identity invested in that. And I don't want to be disrespectful to what other people believe, or step on something that has a lot of meaning to people. So you might want to just like turn off right now if you don't want to hear, I mean, because the evidence is overwhelming if you care to look at it. It's kind of like, you know, in The Lord of the Rings, the first one, Fellowship of the Ring, where they come up to the mines of Moria, remember? And Gandalf doesn't want to go in there. He's like, well, let's find a different way. I don't want to go in the mines of Moria, because he knows there's something there that he's going to encounter that's going to be really powerful, which ends up, you know, no spoilers, but taking him down into the bottomless pit, right? And he says, when they get, he says, come on, let's go over the mountain pass. But of course, Saruman shuts that off with his storms that he summons up. So they go under. And when he's talking about what happened to the mines of to all the dwarves, he said, you know, they delved too deep and they woke something up. So if you, you know, if you dig really deep, you might find things that you didn't expect or weren't ready to face. But guess what? Gandalf, he faces the Balrog, right? And he comes back as actually a different figure, right? He's a totally different Gandalf. That's actually a pattern. J.R.R. Tolkien, of course, was a professor. He was a professor of myth. He was one of the first serious essays about Beowulf, the old English poem Beowulf. Mm-hmm. He knew the myths. That is actually a very common pattern where you have two figures who are one person in the myths, and it represents our ordinary self and kind of our higher self, right? He starts off as Gandalf the Grey. He comes back as Gandalf the White. We find this pattern over and over. This is a bit of a diversion, but we find this pattern over. It's not a diversion because I'll tie it back to your question, CK. We find this pattern in the myths of, like, Achilles has this very close buddy named in the Iliad, Patroclus. And Patroclus dies, and that's when Achilles just goes on a rampage. And actually in the Bible, this exact same pattern happens with Jesus and Lazarus. Jesus weeps over the death of Lazarus, just as Achilles weeps over the grave of Patroclus all night long. Jesus is a higher self figure. In fact, there's a figure called Thomas who is one of the 12 disciples who is known as Doubting Thomas, right? But his nickname or his last name, so to speak, in the Bible is Thomas Didymus. He's actually called this in the scriptural text, Thomas Didymus. It means Thomas the twin, but we never get told who his twin is. So there's all these twin patterns in myths around the world, Castor and Pollux, Achilles and Patroclus, Gandalf, that's later. But Thomas's twin is actually Jesus. When Thomas, and that's actually found in some Gnostic texts where Jesus says, well, you are my brother and my twin. Well, we're never told in the nativity scene that there was two babies there in the manger and there were twins.
Sure.
Right? So, that doesn't get included in the canonical texts, but these myths are actually about reconnecting, or I believe that one of the central themes in these myths is about reconnecting with your authentic self, which is something that we can all relate to and we all need very much in the modern world. We can come back to that. Reconnecting with your authentic self is a very central theme in the myths. When we see Gilgamesh and Enkidu, they're twins, but one of them lives among the animals and one of them is semi-divine. And yet then they come together and then they wrestle and then they love each other like husband and wife. And all the modern interpretation of that is, oh, it must be some kind of a homoerotic relationship. And you'll hear about that in English departments. Or Achilles and Patroclus is presented that way. And, you know, that's an interpretation, but what I think it really is about is those aren't two different people. Those are one person, and it's us becoming reconnected with our authentic self. That's what the myths are really showing. So back to your question about the literalist, I was taking the Bible very literally. Some of the first myths in the stories in the Bible that I started to see were connected to the stars were the Samson myth. And I've talked about that in some videos, and we could, if you want to pull on the thread further, I could go into the Samson myth. And then, like I said, there's a passage in Revelation chapter 9, which was a very big eye-opener to me, because it's extremely clear, if you know the stars, that that passage is talking about, it's the opening of the sixth seal and the keys to the bottomless pit. And then a smoke arises from the bottomless pit. And on either side of the smoke, we have these scorpion men with stingers like scorpions, but they're also centaurs and they're also wearing golden crowns. Well, guess what? The smoke from the bottomless pit, from the altar, there's actually a constellation called the altar, and that's right below or to the south of the brightest and thickest and most brilliant part of what do you think might be the smoky smoke rising up from the bottomless pit in the heavens, if you had to guess? It looks like smoke rising up. A column is shining. It could be a pillar of fire. If you're familiar with the Bible, you may know that Moses and the children of Israel follow a column of smoke by day, a pillar of fire by night. It could look like a pillar of fire. Can you think of any feature in the sky that looks like that?
The meteor shower or some...
I mean, the only thing I can think of is stuff that you can't see with the naked eye, right? Like the pillars of creation or maybe like a nebula of some kind, but...
Or the colors added later.
Yeah, right?
Yeah, you guys are too knowledgeable and you're thinking of things that are like really technical.
Too many documentaries.
It's much more obvious than... It's much more obvious. Even a meteor shower doesn't really look like a pillar of fire, although it's cool looking. I would argue that the Milky Way itself looks a lot...
entire galaxy.
Yeah. We went way too far. Yeah. We were way too far.
The Milky Way, and the brightest part of it is actually in between Scorpio and Sagittarius. And right next to Sagittarius, we have the Southern Crown. And all those elements are right there in the book of Revelation when they're talking about the smoke coming up from the bottomless pit, and they have stingers like scorpions, and they are like horses unto battle, Sagittarius, and they have golden crowns, and they have long hair, and all these things are clear celestial markers. And so that was the second one that I saw after the Samson one, and I said, oh man, then maybe there is something to this. And knowing the Bible as I did and knowing the stars as I did, then I started seeing more and more and more. And so when you see a lot of evidence that refutes your paradigm, you can do one of two things, or you can do a few things, but you could change your paradigm, or you could try and unsee it. And, you know, and what'll happen is you'll split your personality even more, mm-hmm. trying to deny what you actually already know. So anyway, I was going to church. I was raising my children in a way that was literalistic. I was believing, I think there's a lot of things that there's a reason why I was believing all those things, because there are a lot of answers that it has for you, a lot of beauty and truth in there. I believe there's so much beauty and truth in all of these ancient myths and scriptures and sacred stories. But I also believe that when you take them literally, it tends to change the message in such a way that it actually inverts the message, and because it externalizes the message. Remember, I said, I think this is about reconnecting with your higher self.
Right.
The message is actually within you. But if because of an external understanding, you're chasing after something that's outside of you, you might end up with a culture where, see if this sounds familiar, we're experts at chasing after everything outside of us that we think is going to satisfy us, and it never actually does. And we don't live in the present moment. We'll do everything to live, escape the present moment in some way or another.
Right.
And the other thing is, it's a trauma-inducing. There's trauma-inducing aspects to, you are born in sin, and all these sorts of things that tend to trauma. As I've just recently, even after I published this book, but I got to mention it because it's so exciting to me, some of the things that he's talking about. There's a psychiatrist named Gabor Mate who talks about so many of our problems have to do with trauma that splits us apart from our authentic self. And when I heard that, like I said, I only encountered his stuff after this most recent book that just came out last month. But I've been listening to it like a podcastaholic, because the things he's talking about are exactly what I believe the ancient myths are trying to help us solve: recovery of our authentic self. But when you do things like, you know, spanking an infant or something, which the Bible, you know, or literalists will tell you that's okay, or actually you got to do that. It says it right here, and spare the rod, spoil the child.
Right.
It doesn't actually say that, but it says things like the father has, you know, this power to discipline and things like that. You can actually induce trauma. And I think there's a lot of cultures that had sacred traditions that were given to them that didn't induce that kind of trauma in their kids, and ended up with a lot more integrated and less messed up people. And that's why so many people in the world, the Western world today, are now seeking out that ancient wisdom from other cultures, you know, whether it's Native American or ancient India or Buddhism or wherever it comes from. But actually, I think that all the world's ancient myths are based on this same wisdom. It's just that when we take it literally, we tend to turn it upside down. So yeah, I mean, I'm giving away a little personal stuff here, but about my own self, but you know, it was part of what I went through. I'm sorry my kids, you know, went through that, and then I had to change, you know. So it's probably pretty disorienting for them, but I had to admit, hey, you know, I was totally wrong about this. So long story short, I actually believe that now I still love to read the Bible, and I believe that the truth and the beauty that is in there comes through far more powerfully when you understand it in the language that it's actually speaking, which happens to be a metaphorical language, which you can show by the fact that all these figures are based on the stars.
And I'm really interested to kind of pull out the thread that is, you know, connecting with the authentic self, David. I think that that's a fascinating rabbit hole for us to jump down. We do have to take a quick break, but let's unpack that a little bit more when we hop back in. So for everybody out there listening, thank you so much for tuning in so far with our conversation with David Mathisen. More from David after the break.
And we are back with David Mathisen. For those who are just popping in, David was actually just getting into one of the deeper conversations that I've been a part of in a moment. And just to continue to do what the show does and keep going down the rabbit hole, I wanted to know if you could just shed a little bit more light on something you were just talking about. I thought it was really fascinating. And I will admit that the only reason I know about Dr. Matei's work is because of your podcast and your blog, or the podcast that was on your blog about this. And I was, you know, kind of blown away by the simplicity of it. But could you speak a little bit about the idea of connecting sort of celestial mechanics and the nature of our connection to either celestial histories or some forgotten celestial origins with the idea that we have throughout the course of our life been subject to sort of this PTSD of the trauma of the separation from our own authentic self? How do you, in your research, kind of pair those two things together?
Mm-hmm. Right. It's a great question. Before I answer it, I do want to make clear, you know, I reference Dr. Matei because I think his work is fascinating and important, but I don't want to imply that he knows of or by any means endorses my work.
Absolutely. Yeah, no, I appreciate that disclaimer, but I see it more as you shedding light on something that you were really fascinated by.
Yeah, for sure.
Right on. Yeah. And I recommend his work to anyone, especially anyone with children, but everyone. But the ancient myths can be clearly shown to have a pattern of twinning, like, you know, identical twins, that pops up in myths around the world. In the Maya myths, there are twins. whose names are Hunapu and Shabalanke. And I may not be pronouncing that perfectly, but that is a twin pattern in the Maya Popol Vuh. And we mentioned in the first part, Castor and Pollux, which the twins of Gemini in the sky that you can see are usually identified with Castor and Pollux, and the brightest stars of that constellation are called Castor and Pollux. Well, those twins were actually, one was a divine twin, one was immortal, one was mortal. Well, that's really an interesting part of the pattern, because we find this again and again in the twins around the world. I mentioned Jesus and Thomas, or Jesus and Lazarus. We also have twins in the Old Testament. And there's twins, and I'm going to answer your question, CK, by referring to the Gilgamesh epic, where we have the twins of Gilgamesh, who is two-thirds divine, but he has some problems. He is terrorizing and being a tyrant to his people of the city of Uruk in ancient Mesopotamia. He's not leaving any of the people alone, and he's kind of got the he's exercising the right of first knight that you see in Braveheart,
right,
where they a couple gets married, and then the king comes in and says, okay, great, congratulations on getting married, I get to sleep with her first.
The prima nocta,
that's what Gilgamesh is doing, and everybody's complaining to the gods, hey, this is oppressive, this is not right, this is not in the order of things, gods, please help us out here, do something. And they create a twin for Gilgamesh. Actually, it's the mother goddess who creates a twin out of clay. She makes Enkidu, who is a very much the same stature and powerful build as Gilgamesh, but he's covered with hair. He's hairy. And the goddess plops Enkidu down in the middle of the wilderness, whereas Gilgamesh is in this city of Uruk. And Enkidu is just a wild man of nature. He is running with the herds of the field. He is drinking at their water holes. The animals are his friends, and he gets along with them. He is connected to nature in a way that, you know, we all kind of long to be connected to our natural world like that. And the hunters, there's this young hunter who goes out, and he's at the water hole, and he comes face, and he sees Enkidu. He comes face to face with Enkidu, and he's terrified by this wild man. And the hunter runs home and tells his father, who's also an older hunter, and he says, I've seen the wild man. I know who it is. This is the guy who's been letting the animals out of our traps. This is the one who's been steering them away from, you know, our nets. He's protecting the animals from us. And I saw him at the waterhole, and he frightened me. And the dad says, okay, so he's a human being, but he's running with the animals. I've got it. Here's what we'll do. We need to get, do you know the story by any chance? We need to get a woman. That's what we need to do. let's get a temple prostitute who, you know, it was like, actually there was sacred prostitution is what the scholars believe in some of these cultures, where it was related somehow to the worship of the gods. But anyway, they got this beautiful prostitute whose name is Shamhat. She's, you know, this gorgeous woman. And she says, yeah, what do you need? And she goes out to the woods, and they say, listen, all you need to do is seduce this wild man. The dad says, once he sleeps with her, the animals won't want anything to do with him anymore. That'll be it. He'll be cut off from nature. And that's what actually happens. She lays her blanket down, or she takes all her clothes off and lays them down on the ground. And then Enkidu is just, you know, fascinated, of course, and starts to make love to her for, I think, 7 days in a row, you know, nonstop. And then she says, okay, let's go back to civilization now. And he's like, great, I'm with you. You know,
the world was weird before Tinder.
I know it's probably, you know, listeners are probably saying this is so out of touch with modern sensibilities, but this is in the ancient myths, and I would say it's not literal. It's trying to teach us something about what happens is he sees his friends, the animals, and he tries to run after them, and they all run away from him. And he finds he doesn't even have the legs speed to keep up with them anymore. And something has been lost. And then he comes into a camp of shepherds, and he doesn't even know how to eat human food. And Shamhat shows him and says, well, here's some bread and here's some wine. Well, that's pretty interesting, actually, bread and wine. Now, some translators say bread and mead or bread and beer, that we have this pattern actually in a lot of stories. Obviously, in the Bible, there's bread and wine. In the New Testament, there's also bread and wine in the Old Testament when Abraham and Melchizedek, there's an encounter between Melchizedek actually is the one who provides bread and wine in the Old Testament. And it's actually the same constellations as I unpack in my book, Star Myths of the Bible. But anyway, back to Shamhat and Kidu, he's hanging out with the shepherds. And then a traveler comes along the road and says, oh, I'm heading to a wedding. But of course, you know, Gilgamesh is, the king is going to sleep with the wife, you know, the first night. And Enkidu is like infuriated. He says, wait a minute, that's not right. He's already got a fully developed sense of justice. And he says, that is just not right. I'm going to go put an end to that guy. Well, this is what the gods created Enkidu to do, was to fix Gilgamesh. Gilgamesh actually turns into a better character, but at the beginning he's this tyrant. So anyway, Enkidu goes into town. They have this big wrestling match. He stands in front of the house of the bride, and when Gilgamesh is going to come in and go into the bride, Enkidu says, "No, you're not." And they wrestle. And at the end, actually, the text actually says he bends the knee, which is an interesting, you know, textual reference that you guys are familiar with. Sure. I've heard you talk about, you know, bending the knee.
Yeah.
It became important in a recent series, but it actually says that, bends the knee. And remember how I said that the constellation Hercules has this very distinctive posture of a deep knee bend. Mm-hmm. It doesn't actually, scholars argue over which one won. Was it Enkidu or was it Gilgamesh? It only says he bends the knee, but most people think that it was Gilgamesh finally gave up and Enkidu beat him. But what happens after a big fight between two rivals? Of course, they become great buddies. They become fast friends. They do everything together. They go off on adventures together. And it's because what I would argue is being shown here is our loss of, we get entangled with more and more with civilization as we're, when we're babies, we get entangled with civilization when we start to be told by our parents, no, you can't do that. Wait, no, you have to do this. And we start to learn all these rules that when you identify with it, when you internalize it, mm-hmm. into yourself and it becomes like part of you. Well, it creates kind of a self that weighs this versus that, a doubting self that says, wait, in this situation, should I say this or should I say this? Should I wear this? Should I wear that? Those are important skills. Jesus never says to doubting Thomas, oh, doubting Thomas, I wish you would just get away from me. You're useless. No, but the right relationship has to be restored because our doubting self is, it's this ego. Dr. Mate calls it the egoic mind that it's all these defense mechanisms that we've developed sometimes to childhood trauma, where we don't want to let go of sometimes patterns of behavior that we've developed that are actually very harmful to us, obstacles to us. There are myths where even Thor, his mistaken beliefs become an obstacle to him, and one of my favorite Norse myths. But anyway, we are our own worst enemies. The myths show us this over and over, especially in the story of Thor and the Jotun Utgardsloki that I talk about in volume 4. But anyway, as Enkidu encounters civilization, he loses his connection to the wider world. The text even says it, but he gains a different kind of understanding. But then we can't go back to where we were, but we have to become integrated with our higher self. And the myths are showing that how to regain what was lost. We can't go back and get it like where we came from. We have to kind of transcend and reconnect with a higher self. And they show us ways to do that. So I'll just pause there for a second.
No, you mentioned ego of mind, David. And, you know, I've been studying Buddhism since I was 15 years old. And there's a Buddhist term called ego of self. And ego of self is related to attachment and also the need to strike attachment from one's mind. Are you seeing any connections between these myths and this, need to reconnect with the authentic self as it relates to Buddhism and that culture and just that philosophy in general?
Yeah, it's an excellent question, Andrew. And Buddhism, so in this most recent book, The Ancient Worldwide System, Buddhism is usually taught as, well, you know, the myths of India, they had so many gods, they had hundreds of gods and goddesses and these powerful deific beings or supernatural beings like yakshas and all these different supernatural beings. And then Buddhism was kind of a reaction against that. Let's get away from all that mythological stuff and get down to, just philosophical meditation and reject all that. But I find abundant evidence that actually the story of the life of the Buddha follows this same pattern. And I talk about it in this most recent book, the 912-page Ancient Worldwide System. So you'll find a chapter in there on the life of the Buddha. The birth of the Buddha, the pattern of how his birth is described is almost, there are such strong parallels to the birth of the Christ story in the New Testament, which is, you know, the Buddha supposedly lived 500 BC. So this is a very interesting fact that there are extremely close parallels in the birth story. But also, I find evidence that the Buddha figure is actually related to a specific constellation, and it's the same constellation that the Christ figure relates to. It's a very important constellation, and so I'm going to tie it into your question of what about this detachment. It's a constellation called Ophiuchus, and Ophiuchus is not a super well-known constellation. We're familiar, most of us are at least familiar with the zodiac constellations, right? If I were to say, you know, what's your sign? Would you guys know what your sign is?
Yeah.
So, either you guys an Ophiuchus?
I don't think I'm an Ophiuchus.
I don't think so.
Yeah, I don't
believe have you ever met a woman, you know, when you were talking about what's your sign and she said, oh, I'm an Ophiuchus? No. Because there's 12 zodiac signs, right? Aries, Taurus, Gemini, Cancer. But there's actually a 13th zodiac sign and it's Ophiuchus. Ophiuchus has a little part of the constellation where the sun's ecliptic path goes through. So it's actually in the zodiac, but it's left out of the zodiac. It participates in the zodiac, and yet it is detached from the zodiac. And so in this study, I found it really fascinating that, you know, over and over, these important figures, it's not just Jesus and the Buddha, it's also Shiva, it's also Vishnu, it's also Odin. Odin is this very intriguing figure. He's very different from Zeus. He does this kind of self-sacrifice where he hangs himself on the Yggdrasil, the world tree, where he gets this new insight. It's a figure who's connected, but also in some way detached. He's in the 13th zodiac is like that. He's part of the zodiac, or she. Ophiuchus figures are often a she also. Hmm. Athena is a Ophiuchus figure, I would argue. The goddess of wisdom in ancient Greece. It is a figure that is connected but also detached. And I think that is part of the answer that these myths are telling us of how to reconnect with your authentic self. When you see your egoic mind doing something, and Dr. Mate talks about this, is why I get so excited when I'm listening to his work. He says, when you're, let's say you have an addiction, and he says, you know, it's not just a heroin addict has an addiction. Addiction could be to any pattern that you keep returning to over and over, even though you realize that it has some negative consequences, you know, some bad negative consequences, but you go back to it over and over again.
Sure.
You don't have to answer me, but have you ever had one of those?
Yeah,
you know,
for sure.
I know
of
I
course.
Have.
For sure.
I know I have. Well, he says, you know, it's a totally different perspective if you can look at that pattern as, I'm feeling a real need for X right now, whatever it happens to be. It could be a substance. It could be a behavior. Why am I feeling that right now? I'm feeling that because I'm anxious about this interview I'm about to do with Andrew and CK, or I don't know, this MMA fight I'm about to do, or whatever.
Those are two very different things, yeah, David.
But I'm just talking about anxiety, you know? I mean, when we look at our society, there is a serious problem with anxiety. There's something like 2 people out of 10 have been diagnosed with serious anxiety disorders. Mm-hmm. Well, Dr. Mate would say that's because of a separation from yourself. But if you can start to look, okay, why am I needing this? And even if you say, okay, right now I can't handle the need for it is too much, I'm going to have a little bit of that, whatever it is that I want, that I'm addicted to. It's a totally different perspective now, because you're a little bit detached from it. You're looking at yourself from a different perspective, and you're realizing, okay, I'm going to give into that right now because I need it. But I'm starting to identify what's going on in myself, and that the detachment, because your egoic mind is only a little tiny part of you. That's what these myths are talking about when they have a twinned pair, like Thomas and Jesus. We all have these doubts that are running through our mind all the time. Those actually can help us. If I'm driving my car and I think, did I turn off the stove? You know, I wasn't paying attention when I left the house because I wasn't in the present. I was thinking about this interview I'm going to do in 15 minutes, or this date that I'm about to go on. And I'm like, wait a minute, did I even turn off the stove when I cooked those scrambled eggs this morning? And I go back and check and I find out I didn't. That was actually a good doubt, right?
Sure.
But why did that happen? It's because you weren't living in the present. You were. It's like, I use the metaphor a lot. I know you've heard it before, but it's like Mr. Miyagi and Daniel-san. Daniel-san had to be taught in a different way, with wax on, wax off, because his egoic mind would have just choked on what Mr. Miyagi was trying to teach him. And then when the light came on, it was a beautiful thing. We all remember that scene, the wax on, wax off scene, when Daniel-san finally realizes what's going on. Well, there's so much in your body that is in your subconscious that is connected to the wider world. Our little egoic mind that we've constructed as part of being connected and entangled into this society is just a tiny part, and it actually keeps us from a lot of what's going on. Our gut is full of sensors that is connected to things that, if we were just paying attention, our subconscious actually knows it already, but our conscious mind doesn't know it. Our skin, but even we're strangely connected to invisible things that people can't even explain, where people get premonitions. I've talked about this story about this young boy who was 11. His name's Norman Olestad, and he wrote this great book called Crazy for the Storm, where he had to survive this terrible plane crash and he was the only survivor. He had to get down off the mountain. Well, he got down successfully, but he wouldn't have been found by anybody in this remote place unless 2 different people had these unexplainable premonitions, where they went out to start looking around and calling into the forest, like, is anyone out there? And that's how he got found. Now, how do you explain that, except that our subconscious is connected to, even just like our gut is gathering data, is like a bank of sensors that we're not even usually paying attention to. Our subconscious is connected in ways to actually the universe and to other people, to other people's subconsciouses, in ways that our little egoic mind isn't paying attention to. But if we could, like through meditation and some of those ancient disciplines that you're talking and referring to, Andrew, and maybe participating in, like meditation, yoga, tai chi, martial arts, those are things where you can find yourself. You can find yourself, and you can actually start to become more integrated with yourself. So that's what I think these myths are actually showing us. That's one of the things they're showing us.
And, you know, David, you mentioned earlier, you were talking about how some of your grounding in this field and some of the motivations that, that brought you here were from some of the time that you spent with your own dad when you were growing up. And Andrew and I are young parents. We, you know, often talk about just the challenges associated with, you know, raising kids in a rapidly changing world. We also have a pretty serious personal concern about raising kids who are authentically open and able to be themselves. And so, I really appreciate you getting into the depth that you were discussing there. But one last thing that I wanted to ask you about just on this topic is just, you know, as you're thinking about your own kids and you're thinking about what you're doing as a parent, and you've touched on a couple of different really heady things here that, you know, have both come from your work and your experience with them. But can you kind of tell some of the listeners, you know, who are, might be dealing with this same kind of stuff is, you know, A, are there some things you enjoy doing with your kids that have to do with the stars, whether it's walking around at night and, you know, looking at the same book or doing some of the things you did with your dad? Or are there some things that you have done that kind of allow you to have a more natural conversation about this really, really heady stuff with your own kids?
Wow, that's a really wonderful question. And I'll have to admit, I haven't, you know, I would first recommend everyone go read Gabor Mate that has kids. He has a book actually called Hold On Tightly to Your Children or something like that. Hold On to Your Kids. And you know, my sons are now 20 and 18. And I have to do sometimes some repairing of the relationship because, you know, you don't crank out this many books without being a bit of a workaholic. And you know what? Everyone, we were just talking about the subconscious, can pick up, you know, even if you really love your kids, their subconscious might pick up, wait a minute, dad, you know, only pays attention to me when I do this or whatever. And it can lead to kind of patterns of, you know, it's like our subconscious knows, your subconscious knows even when your conscious mind doesn't admit it. You know, if your wife was having an affair, I mean, it's terrible with someone else, a terrible example, but your subconscious would know, even if you're conscious, long before your conscious mind finally admitted to it.
Sure.
And I would say that children, when their parents are distracted, or maybe their parents are stressed out, or they're fighting over something, even though those parents really love the child's subconscious is picking it up and getting the message of, there's something wrong and maybe I caused it or something. Anyway, so I appreciate the question. I haven't been always the best, you know. Now in retrospect, I'm like, oh, well, my sons are 20 and 18. Why did I only just now discover Dr. Gabor Mate's work? But I did do, you know, it's not all negative, of course. I read the Norse myths to them, the Greek myths to them, the the whole Lord of the Rings to them. I think reading to your children is just totally, you know,
the best.
They don't even have to be old enough to know all the vocabulary. They're getting on a subconscious level that you love them and that this is an important thing to you. And then they're going to find reading important. And if you take them out to see the stars, so the H.A. Rey outlines of the stars, a new way to see them, are really, really helpful. But even with those, picking out these constellations are not easy. It takes time. Mm-hmm. So what I would recommend doing is going out and really consult that book before you go out and look at the stars, and it'll take you some time. A metaphor I've used is like if you move to a strange town or you move to a new place and you start going to a bar in that town, you won't know anybody. You'll be the stranger. But if you go there week after week, after a while, you'll start to get to know some people, and then you'll know where this guy sits or that girl sits and or that woman sits and that. And then you'll say, wait a minute, Jim isn't here tonight. Where is Jim? Or wait a minute, Jim is sitting in a different place than he normally sits, because you'll have started to, that will happen. They'll start to become your friends, and then everyone will know your name, right? Or you'll know everyone's name.
I see
name.
What you did there.
Right. But the same will happen with the constellations. When you first start going to that night sky, you'll be a total stranger. Uh-huh. But just remember, if you keep going, pretty soon you'll be like, well, wait a minute, there's Sagittarius, or there's Scorpio. Those are some of the easier ones. Ophiuchus and Hercules are harder. Now, I do have some videos that help show people how to find them. And of course, you know, you can check out my books and I talk about them. And if you start connecting them up with the myths, then you'll really start to, you know, they'll become even more personal to you, because you'll be like, ooh, Sagittarius. Well, I just happen to know that connects up with Apollo and Artemis, and that's fascinating to me. And it'll become even more personal. You get to know more of their deeper story.
It's great, though, that it's so accessible now, too, like specifically to the night sky. I can remember, you know, living in Denver years ago, my daughter was, I think, 3 and 4, and she just had this fascination with the universe and with the night sky. And you know, we would watch a ton of documentaries on just the universe in general. And like, I mean, here I am in my living room with a 3.5-year-old talking about like black holes and quasars and pulsars and like all these things. And I took her down to DU and they have just this amazing site there where you can, you know, go as a thriving community too, where it's not just like the main telescope where you can go see the stars. And we were able to see Andromeda through that system. But they have all these like different members of the community that bring their telescopes out and they teach people about the different constellations, about the different planets, and they just make it so accessible. So like, if that's a thing for any of our listeners, I mean, I know that there are so many of those programs and organizations out there in your local area that could definitely, you know, turn a regular Friday night with you and your kiddo into something that's, you know, a pretty amazing lasting memory. So
yeah, and it's totally free to go look at the stars pretty much if you're able to do it. So I do remember what I was going to say. So your question, CK, had some really good nuances to it about, well, what I thought about was, I think it's great to teach the myths. You don't actually have to say that they're connected to the stars right away. I mean, I think it's okay to teach your kids that there's a Santa Claus, and then later, you know, there's a guy named Santos Bonacci. I don't know if you've heard of Santos Bonacci, but he talks about there's kind of a higher message to a lot of these things, including the Santa Claus story being about, oh, well, you know, your pituitary gland, you know, secretes a certain secretion that causes like DMT, and it drops down the chimney, you know, into your system. And that's what the Santa Claus story is all about. You know, whether or not that's true, you know, I think it's a fascinating thing. But the reason he explains it that way is to say, you don't have to tell your kids that right away. You can say, now do you, when they're old enough, you can say, now do you want to know what this is really about? Instead of just a letdown that, I don't want anyone to be listening and get a spoiler, but instead of just a letdown, you know, you can say, hey, this is actually about something higher, but you learned it as a child. That's actually somewhere I read that Aristotle defined the esoteric as you learn something first, then you get its meaning. And if you're familiar with Montessori, have you ever heard of Montessori?
Totally.
Montessori is a great, my mom is a Montessori teacher, so that's in the mix too. I started off, I was in Montessori preschool through kindergarten, actually all the way up through third grade. I think Montessori is fantastic because it's actually an esoteric way of teaching. They have a thing called the binomial cube. They have a thing called the trinomial cube, and you learn to put it together when you're literally 3, 4, 5 years old. Now, how many 3, 4, 5-year-olds can do a trinomial and cube it? That means A plus B plus C, put parentheses around it, put a little, you know, exponential 3, and then you have to multiply that thing out to get A cubed plus A squared B plus, well, what happens in Montessori is you learn the cube, then when you're old enough, the teacher says to you, and now I'm going to teach you about how to cube a trinomial, and then they show you the formula, and then they say, and by the way, you already know this. It's exactly like Mr. Miyagi and Daniel-san. And the child goes, what do you mean? I already know this. Well, let's pull out the trinomial cube. Now look at this block right here. This represents the variable A. And you see how it's a cube right here and it's red on all sides? That red cube is A cubed. But this block here only has red on the two square surfaces. That's A squared times the height B. And the child's mind goes, boom, pop. I get it. I understand a trinomial. Wow. And it's like that's the way the myths can also be. You can teach the children the myths before you even explain, guess what? This is actually about reconnecting with your higher self, or this is actually about this. So I don't think you have to.
It's like stepping stones into it.
Exactly. Yeah, it's like the Montessori method of myths.
I love it.
Or the Daniel-san method of myths. And before I forget, I do want to mention, Andrew, you've had on this new segment that I heard for the first time on the season 2. Congratulations on bringing it back. And you had Eden come on, right?
Yep.
And so your daughter's name is Eden. Well, guess what? There's an Eden in the Bible, and the Adam and Eve and the serpent all get thrown out of Eden. Well, it's actually, I've seen Eden. It's in the sky. They get cast down out of the sky when the sky turns and the constellations that represent Adam and Eve and the serpent sink down into the western horizon. They've been cast out of the glorious Eden in the heavens. Well, that's actually a picture of what happens to us. We're here in this incarnate body that's made out of clay. That's like the stars sinking down into the western hemisphere, into either earth or water. They've come down out of the higher realm, the invisible realm, the infinite realm, into this lower realm. So we're all a combination of both. We all have infinite and we have mortal, you know, mixed together at every single point. And that's what I think that story is showing. So Eden would naturally probably love the stars, because the sky, that's actually what I believe you're looking at, the Garden of Eden right there.
And she has. She's loved them since, I mean, she was, you know, 3 years old. It's always been a fascination for her. And I know that she's going to listen to this episode and just be so pumped that, you know, there was a shout out for her.
When I heard that,
too.
I was like, well, what a great name. And it connects right in with the stars. But actually, all of our names, you know, both of your names refer to figures in the Bible
right,
as well, as does mine.
What a perfect way to bring it home. And David, really, I personally appreciate so much you spending time. I know, you know, sometimes when we're just talking about work and we're just talking about the research, so often, you know, things get really technical and we spend a lot of time, you know, going down all of these different threads. But in this case, you went down a personal, emotional, spiritual thread that I hope the listeners really appreciate as much as I did. One more thing, you know, you've mentioned your website a few times throughout the course of the podcast. And, you know, we've talked about the books a little bit, but before we let you go, could you just make sure to let listeners know what is your main website, and also just one more time, the title of the book that's just coming out?
Yeah.
Well, thanks for asking that. And my website is called starmythworld.com, which is kind of a shortened version of Star Myths of the World, but the website is starmythworld.com. And if you happen to forget that, you can just actually search for Mathisen and stars, and you'll probably come across, you know, maybe one of my YouTube videos or something, and should have links to get back to starmythworld.com. But there, everything is there. So there's a section of videos, there's a section with a blog that's been going for over 1,100 blog posts now. Ooh, and then it's fully searchable. It's a lot. It actually kind of chronicles my development through this too. You can kind of trace, if you go back far enough, you'll get to where I was believing it literally. But there's actually selections from all of my books there too. So there's some sample content in the books section. And my most recent book, thanks for asking, is called The Ancient Worldwide System, because this really is, it's an ancient system that predates Egypt. It predates Mesopotamia. It predates ancient India, ancient China, because all those myths, the earliest ones that we have from those cultures, are already using this system. In fact, in one of my books, I talk about how it connects possibly to Göbekli Tepe. We don't have time to go into that now. But anyway, the ancient worldwide system, it's a system that's all around us, and yet it's kind of buried in the jungle and underneath the sands, and it only pokes out here and there. So we're all living within it, this ancient worldwide system.
I think maybe we need to potentially do a follow-up, you know, and we can go down that rabbit hole that is Göbekli Tepe. And I still have, you know, like 9 questions on my sheet here.
So many things you couldn't get to.
Yeah, I think we should definitely explore that, and we can get something on the books, you know, straight away. But David, as always, it's such a pleasure talking to you. I'm so glad that you're continuing this quest for you know, just answers and truth. And it's awesome talking to you, and we really appreciate you carving out time for
so
us.
So much for your time today. Yeah. Really appreciate it.
Well, thank you both so much for bringing out. I really like where the conversation went. And so I thank you for bringing that out. And I hope that the listeners like where it went. I hope it was all positive and not negative for people. And thank you so much for having me on. It's been great.
Listen, if you spoiled Christmas and Santa Claus for anyone out there,
yeah, that's on us. That's on us.
We'll, and to make it right, hit us up on
put
social
it in
media.
The intro.
Yeah. Disclaimer. Your children are listening.
Put on headphones.
It's going to get deep.
But if David did spoil Christmas for you, just hit us up on social media and we'll send you a Lost Origins t-shirt.
Yeah.
To compensate
you
for your
every
troubles.
Kid wants. That's it. Well, thank you so much, David. Really appreciate it.
Thank you. Have an awesome one, man.
Best wishes, guys, with your podcast. It's
thank
great.
Thank you. Cheers. Whoa.
Well, that just got really heady really, really quickly.
It, like, I'm
our
so
man
glad
is on
it,
some other stuff.
Yeah.
I love it.
I love it too, man. I'm glad it went that direction. Like the last time he was on the show, we had like, you know, a really good conversation, but, you know, we talked more about, you know, myths and like tied him into the megalithic record. And, you know, it was very much in line with like the quote unquote format of the show, I suppose.
Awesome stuff.
Yeah, it was amazing. Awesome stuff. But I'm really glad that we
clearly he's on some new like trans parental journey. It seems like he's very thoughtful right now, mm-hmm. Aside from just his deep, you know, research into mythology and just mythos and global mythos and global structures of mythos. Mm-hmm. Like, it seems like he is on a personal journey right now that I can imagine probably the majority of listeners to the Lost Origins podcast are on similarly. And I know that you and I are as well, is just trying to figure out, okay, you know, all of these theories are really awesome. Mm-hmm. All of these just reimagining, re-envisioning, getting better, more accurate understandings of where we came from as a species, as a wet, squishy creature that we are. That's all really awesome. But at the end of the day, I think probably all of us have some motivation as well to say, okay, well, there's this maybe more energy focused or something that is less physical that we're all also really researching. And it's cool to see somebody at David's level, you know, and the conclusions that they're coming to and, you know, even giving people some things that they can be doing with their own kids, mm-hmm. and their own life. And
yeah,
stuff.
For sure. And like speaking about his kids, it's interesting because like, today's episode or interview or conversation, whatever, we had to reschedule because he had an event with one of his sons. His son was accepting an award from school, and that's why awesome. He had to reschedule in the first place. And so
they're demanding.
They are. But in the best way.
Yeah. Right? I mean, like I've seen parents who have attempted to, you know, get some sort of robotic version of themselves or like the great, Gomez Adams phrase where now you get to experience the joy of having a child and paying someone to raise them. but yeah, I think the thing that I've heard, probably the number one secret that old people tell you or older people tell you, like it's just their secret. But the number one thing I hear from all old people is, I wish I spent more time with my young kids.
You and I have talked about that before, too, right? Like
across the board.
Well, because, you know, with work and just like the demand that is the career and you know, with you know, what we've done professionally, you know, it's demanding. And at the end of the day, when it's all over and, you know, you're on your deathbed, you're not going to think back to, remember that one project that I just kicked ass on, or remember that one thing I shipped, right? It's always going to come back to
stars with your kids.
Exactly. It's the simple stuff too. And like the best memories that I have with my three humans are, I mean, we do some pretty cool stuff together. Some big like showboating. And like some big showboaty stuff too. But like the purest, happiest moments that I have with those kids are the like most simple and like no production, just real moments laying on the floor with them.
And they're like exactly, I mean, kids in general have this natural propensity when, you know, David's talking about the authentic self, they just have this really natural propensity to do something that I think our listeners, you know, en masse probably have as a key characteristic. And that is just the idea that they feel zero shame about continuing to ask questions. Mm-hmm. You know, I have no issues with like, well, why is it that way? What's going on with that? And I think so often we spend so much time trying to get kids in line and prepare them for the rigor of social and civil discourse and life. And at the end of the day, thinking about allowing them to just stare at stars, mm-hmm. think about, you know, great animals in the sky and the procession and their introduction to something as complex as cosmology through something as accessible as astrology, mm-hmm. it's pretty magical stuff. Yeah. It's really cool to share that conversation with him today.
Yeah, I thoroughly enjoyed it. And I really do think we need to pull him back on the show because
there's like three or four other things we should have talked about.
For sure. Yeah. And you know, we could probably have like a whole season dedicated to that dude's work. I mean, he's super heady and I like what he's doing out there. So
I'm sorry, what do we have happening next week? Something
next week. Yeah, we do have some crazy stuff. And I think David teed us up pretty perfectly for it.
Yeah, he's talking about the pineal gland a little bit.
Yep, and some DMT action. So we have R.N. Voot coming on the show next week.
R.N. Voot.
Yeah, so he's
be all over the place in so many different cool places.
I know. So we have, he's from Europe, and he does a lot of work, you know, looking at ancient myths and just mysteries in general. But there is an emphasis on DMT and the use of psychedelics within the ancient mysteries space. And he just kind of like walks you through like this story arc, right? And just like connects these dots in terms of like who we are, what our origin is, and what does it mean for, you know, the future of humanity as well. So I'm really excited.
It's so exciting.
Fired up. He's actually, he's this season's like first new guest, which is cool.
Oh, pam, 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 pam.
You did it. I'm so proud of you.
No episode will be spared.
No, I think the ham horn is here to stay. And if that offends you, I'm sorry. No, it's going to be really exciting to get him on the show. I'm excited to dig into his work. I know that the two of you are going to have an amazing, conversation as well. I'm really looking forward to it. So it'll be good stuff.
I'm so psyched for next week.
Yeah. So for everybody out there, make sure that, you know, you hit that subscribe button. You hit us on social media. Any questions or authors, researchers, you know, anybody that you think we need to be bringing on the show or just aware of their work, like, please connect with us and make sure that we're in the know and we've got the inside scoop, if you will. Make sure you check out our website at lost-origins.com. Hit us up on Patreon if you guys feel compelled to support the show. And make sure you tune in next week for our conversation.
Subscribe,
shameless plug. But tune in next week for our conversation with R.N. Voot. And until next time, I'm Andrew.
I'm CK.
And we challenge you to question everything.